Hello and welcome to the Sound Test Live. You know the score by now. It's your weekly celebration of video game music in all of its forms. And oh my, have we got a checklist for you today. This might just be the longest playlist I've ever put together in terms of actual amount of tracks. I mean, it's probably going to come out at the usual two and a half hours, but I think there's up to 20, 21, maybe even 22 different tracks on this goddamn playlist. It's amazing, amazing stuff. We've already kicked off with an interview with Fats Bard. That will be a separate podcast on other platforms if you're listening to this after the fact. Shady is already getting himself ready to play Streets of Rage with some more live streaming if you happen to be watching this in the YouTube version. Oh my word, tonight's show has so much stacked up that there's a couple of things that I've actually had to omit. We've got no VGM SongFight Battle this week. I completely forgot to put a poll up about it. So we'll leave that for a week, and I think you'll see why when we get through this playlist, because it's so stuffed with different things to talk about. We'll leave the VGM SongFight Battle till next week. Sound Effects Showdown, we have got... Oh no, we haven't got a new round, but we will have the answers from last week. However, there is some points confusion, and I'm probably going to have to catch up on things next week. I'll let you guys know exactly what's going on with that when we get to the Sound Effects Showdown. Basically, there's still some extra points that I'm certain that I need to give out. So kicking off the show there, straight after the live interview with Fat Bard, was something from Fat Bard, from their amazing soundtrack to Levelhead, which is full of great kind of peppy electronic music, as well as chilled out ambiences, all sorts, really, just kind of representing Fat Bard's incredible skill at adapting their music to different styles. And the track was called Canopy Slam, with a really funky kind of leading bass line kind of thing. Really, really love that tune. I say it all the time on this show, but it's something that I'm going to have to learn on the bass at some point when I do come back with VGM bass lines. So I probably don't want to talk myself too much on today's show, because it is quite long and I'm worried about how long it's going to go. So the only thing left to say is that we will be doing the whole androids robots thing that we talked about at the end of last show. That was the question that we raised, asking you guys your favourite playable androids, playable artificial intelligences. And I've picked five of my own, as well as going with some of your choices that you guys threw in the chat. So we'll kick straight off with a request. It's got nothing to do with robots or androids. We'll get straight into it, because we want to get Shady streaming on the Streets of Rage. Hopefully also going to get some Golden Axe as well. We may even get some Bomberman action. You never know. So kicking things off, this was a request from Jerry, actually, from a game called, and this was new to me, so let me have a proper look at this. I've had to rejig my whole screen. West of Loathing. This was a completely new game to me, Jerry, so if you've got any information about it, please throw it through in the chat. This is composed by Ryan Ike, and it's called A Cave is a Sideways Hole, which is certainly true.
Thank you. the street, went out the corner of my eye, I saw a pretty little thing approaching me. She said, I never seen a man who looks so all alone, could you use a little company? If you pay the right price, your evening will be nice, and you can go and send me on my way. I said, you're such a sweet young thing, why you do this to yourself? She looked at me, and this is what she said. Oh, there ain't no rest for the wicked. Money don't grow on trees. I got bills to pay, I got mouths to feed. There ain't nothing in this world for free. I know I can't slow down, I can't hold back, though you know I wish I could. I know there ain't no rest for the wicked until we close our eyes for good. Not even 15 minutes later, I'm still walking down the street when I saw the shadow of a man creep out of sight. Your money, not your life. If you try to make a move, I won't think twice. I told him you could have my cash, but first you know I gotta ask, what made you wanna live this kind of life? He said there ain't no rest for the wicked. Money don't grow on trees. I got bills to pay, I got mouths to feed. There ain't nothing in this world for free. I know I can't slow down, I can't hold back, though you know I wish I could. I know there money from the church, he stuffed his bank account with righteous dollar bills. But even still, I can't say much because I know we're all the same. Oh yes, we all seek out to satisfy those thrills. You know there ain't no rest for the wicked. Money don't grow on trees. We got bills to pay, we got mouths to feed. There ain't nothing in this world for free. I know we can't slow down, we can't hold back, though you know we wish we could.
Ain't No Rest for the Wicked by Cage the Elephant, of course, from Borderlands. I think the majority of modern day gamers would know that. Very, very famous licensed track from a modern day franchise, which was suggested by Lewis to represent our first playable Android AI robot character for today. It's not one of my top five because I don't really know that much about Borderlands. Unfortunately, I've barely played it. I played it a little bit, but only for about 10 minutes around at my cousin's house. So I'd really need to give it a bit more attention because I did like its mix of first-person shooting and RPG elements. Really, really interesting stuff. So although that's from Borderlands 1, it represents Lewis bringing to my attention the playable appearance of Claptrap, who's a very famous character from the Borderlands series, in the pre-sequel. I don't think you actually play as Claptrap. I did a little bit of research. I know nothing about Borderlands, but I think I'm actually right about this. You don't actually play as Claptrap as much as you can actually play as the type of robot that he is. It's like a class. It's like an RPG class type thing. Might be wrong on that. You might actually be able to play as Claptrap himself. We've got Lewis and another Lewis. Welcome into the show, Lewis T, whole new listener. Two Lewises in now who are big fans of Borderlands, who could put me back on track about that one. But yes, that is our first androidy kind of character. Nice one. Still gonna tease a little bit before we get any of my personal top five in there. Fortunately, Louis, is it Louis or Lewis? Because it might be Louis, actually. There's a slight difference in spelling there. You let me know. Has told me that I am correct about Borderlands. That's a good start to today's show. We all know what I'm like. It might just unravel as we go along. Well, there's something coming up that's going to unravel me, I think. And it's a choice from Jerry. And I actually think Lewis might have mentioned it, actually. I'm not too sure. But I know for a fact that Jerry did. Mentioned the character, and I'm definitely going to pronounce this wrong, Aigis or Aigis or Aigis, Aigis from Persona, I think it's Persona 3 where they're introduced, but they then go on through multiple games throughout the Persona series. Again, starting off today's show with games that I have barely played. Apologies, guys, but I think I've got my information just about right. It's my pronunciation that I think I've got wrong. And yeah, she is, in fact, an android or a robot or an AI. It's difficult to know exactly what is the right word to use, so we'll go for all three. Just to be safe. But yeah, I apologize for my absolutely dodgy pronunciation there. I'll probably open up the chat and have people spelling it out for me, but Aigis, Aigis. Oh, Louis said I'm pronouncing it right, right? But I pronounced it three different ways. So I'm going to go with Aigis. Aigis's theme, and this is actually from Persona 4 Arena, which is an interesting title because Jerry mentioned the track Heartful Cry to me, which is apparently their main theme overall. And I did look it up and I tried to get a nice crisp quality version of it, but all the versions I could find were pretty nasty, I've got to be honest with you. Not the piece of music, the actual like quality of the file was all no good. So that was probably just my research letting me down again. So I went for this Aigis's theme from Persona 4 Arena, which is a real banger, actually. This is real good stuff. So I'm sorry you haven't got Heartful Cry, but it represents the character nonetheless and continues on the robot theme. Guess what? I've forgotten to do the sound effect showdown. Oh, well, we'll do it next.
We'll be right back.
Crack in the Glass by Fat Bard from Jet Lancer, which we interviewed Fat Bard about five minutes. That would be all kinds of time warpy. No, about half an hour ago, we finished that up. And if you're in the live version, you probably saw it live. If you're not in the live version, you're going to want to check it out as its own separate podcast, because I'll be releasing it as its own thing after the fact when I get everything up on Spotify and everything. And it'll be well worth hearing about both Levelhead, which we kicked off this show with, and Jet Lancer and those thick, thick guitars that you heard right there. We chatted a little bit about their production techniques of that and how they adapt to electronic music as well. Also how they adapt to working under the bloody coronavirus and sound effects as well. All sorts of cool VGM chat going on in that Fat Bard interview, which was just about half an hour ago. Definitely not 5 minutes. But yeah, I have time warped and rushed myself into this episode for sure. Jumped in without even looking back. No, I need to get settled into this episode. For the first time in this show's history, I forgot to do the Sound Effects Showdown in the correct link. I'm blaming all of this on the fact that I've been having a week off this week before getting into working on my racing special podcast next week. I've been having a much needed week off to just binge television and play video games, and I've needed to get my head back into the work mode tonight, actually get myself ready to do a broadcast. So we rushed into this, apologies, but we're here now, we're settled in, and we've got so much great stuff to get through. But we cannot forget the Sound Effects Showdown another time. That simply cannot happen. So what's going to happen with this tonight is, because I have had such a crazy week, well, I say that, although it's basically like I've been totally switched off. So today's been a crazy day attempting to switch myself back on and get all of this stuff back on. So my sound effects points, there's still some missing. I know I still owe some for the Half-Life stuff a couple of weeks ago, for sure. And I realized that last week I was only giving people 1 point when they in fact deserved two. So if you're a new listener and you've got no idea what I'm talking about, you're gonna wanna know. The Sound Effects Showdown is where I play three different sounds from three different games, and you guess what the sounds are and what the games are that they're from for 6 points in total. After 5 weeks, whoever's got the most points wins a special kind of prize. If you're a brand new winner, you'll win a hamper of really cool stuff that I'll personalize for you. If you're a second time winner, I've got a t-shirt idea cooked up for you. And if Shady wins yet again, then we're turning the chalice over to him and he's going to do the sound effects instead, and I'll play along with you guys. So what we're going to do this week is we'll remind you of last week's three sounds, and I want you all to, as per usual, get your answers through in social media, on social media rather, during the next bit of music, as if it was gonna be the final round and I'm counting up all these points. Please do, because as soon as I finish broadcasting, the first thing I'm doing is definitively laying down the Sound Effects Showdown points and getting them definitive. I'm gonna go back through every show with Thor's incredibly helpful YouTube timestamps and get these points 100% nailed down, because we don't want to be shortchanging anybody. And we'll come to that next week. And also, I thought with the VGM SongFight battle taking a week's hiatus as well, it kind of, whatever, we'll come back to the regular features next week. And this can kind of be a casual, strange, kind of relaxing show, since I'm still kind of considering myself in my week off. So before I continue talking myself on and on and on, let's just hear last week's three sounds. This is your last chance. And twice more for now. And Don't forget to give me your answers on social media if you haven't already, because I will be giving the answers out after the next bit of music, and I will therefore not be accepting any answers given after the next bit of music. We are adhering to rules here. Okay, so one thing that I do have nicely set up today, 100% for sure, is all of my robot Android choices, my playable AI choices in my top five today. I definitely have those set up, even if I was a bit weak on the Sound Effects Showdown. We'll come to that next week. For now, let's hear number five on my top five androids, robots, artificial intelligences. We've already heard a couple from people in the chat, and we've got more of those to come. But my first one is a little guy by the name of Vectorman. I knew him best on the Sega Mega Drive, but he was also available on other titles too, at least I think. Actually, I might be wrong on that. I think I'm confusing that with another title later on, but it's definitely Sega Mega Drive. I'm not wrong on that. Because funnily enough, this is one that I didn't actually play when we owned a Mega Drive. This is something that I came to later down the line when they did all of those Sega Mega Drive Super Collections for the PlayStation, and because I think they had one for like the PS2, the PS3, the PS4. They constantly bring out these Sega Mega Collections, and they've always got the same games on. All the Sonics, Dynamite Heady, Echo the Dolphin, Golden Axe, Streets of Rage, all the Mega Drive classics, basically. And that was when I got into Vectorman, and actually really, really enjoyed it and thought it was a fantastic game. I was always annoyed that I wasn't aware of it when I was a kid and actually owned a hardware physical Mega Drive, because that would have been super cool. But nonetheless, I did go back and poke my head into the world of Vectorman and very, very much enjoyed it. So to represent that world and listen to number five in my top five androids, robots, AIs, we're going to hear the options theme from the very first Vectorman game, and it is creamy. Thank you. So here's an interesting one that was actually chosen on Twitter, because this is continuing on with the robots. This is continuing on with the AI and the androids. I won't settle on this whole show on which word I want to use, because I guess it depends on the individual character. In this case, I would say it's probably more of a robot, because that was from Ratchet and Clank. Of course, representing Clank, two 3D platforming heroes, really. And I played a lot of their very first game, but not much of anything else down the line, I'm afraid to say. That was from Ratchet and Clank Going Commando, the second game in the series. It was a track called Mining Area. Really, really nice ambient stuff. And actually, Ratchet and Clank's music is great stuff, and I've always underplayed it on this show, always, especially considering that later down the line, it was worked on by Michael Bross, who I've actually interviewed on the show for the Oddworld special. He's done amazing work on the Oddworld series. We all know what a big fan of that series I am. And we should check in with more of his Ratchet and Clank music. That's one of the things I think I should make a note of myself for this week, for sure. Mining Area, really, really love that one, especially after those creamy, creamy bass frequencies of Vector Man. What a nice number five in my top five. So Mining Area was chosen by someone on Twitter called Maui. I believe they listen to the show. They just don't appear in the chat. They're probably sometime in the week when they listen to it, which is all fine by me. And you know what? I don't think I've ever said your name out loud, because we've interacted a lot on Twitter, but I apologise if it's not Maui, but I think it is. I think that's how you pronounce it. Otherwise, it'd just be like Mao. But I think it's Maui. You let me know in DM, because I'm pretty sure that you do listen to this show. So that one's for you, buddy, representing Clank, which was a really great choice. I used to play Ratchet and Clank, the first game, a lot with Dale when we were kids, when Dale very first got a PlayStation 2, and that's some good, good memories for me. So I'm really glad that that was brought up on Twitter, but it says a lot that it's still not in my top five. But we'll get more answers on that as we go through the show. First off, you guys want answers on the Sound Effects Showdown. So I hope you've given your answers in to me, because this is it. This is the cutoff point. So that was, of course, a limit break from Final Fantasy VII. I would hope, if you've got any history with Final Fantasy VII, if you've played any significant amount of Final Fantasy VII, I would sincerely hope that you're picking that one up. Absolute classic. Another absolute classic, but again, perhaps a little bit generational, picking up a Wumpa Fruit from Crash Bandicoot. I guess any of the first three Crash Bandicoots would have done with that one. It's the same sound, pretty much. So yeah, if you were around for the PS1 era, or even really the Insane trilogy, it's there as well. I think that's pretty iconic, to be fair. You don't get much more iconic than Crash. You have to be looking at characters like Mario, really, to be getting more iconic than Crash Bandicoot. So, final one. And we'll talk over the end of that bad boy, because it is a long one. Is a You Died from Dark Souls, and what I took it from was a Dark Souls 2 rip, actually. I know nothing about the Dark Souls series, absolutely nothing. So I can't actually confirm whether that follows through the series, and if any of you guys have voted just Dark Souls You Died, I'll probably give you it, because I don't know Dark Souls, and I'm willing to bet that that would follow through the series, because I think it's quite iconic, or at least it was labelled as such when I was looking at new sound effects to include in that particular round. So apologies that I don't have a winner for you guys, but again, it leaves the tension, I think, a little bit for next week, while we have this casual robot-y show today. Come back next week with the actual points and an actual winner, and we'll announce what's going on. Is Shady doing the next round for us? Is one of you guys going to win a full-on hamper? Or is one of you second-time winners going to win a t-shirt? We'll find out next week, along with the next chapter of the VGM Songfight Battle, because silly me didn't put the poll up. That's what happens when I have a break. I go completely off the reservation. But I've still managed to get together this amazing playlist nonetheless, with a little help from my friends, of course, you guys in the chat. Fantastic requesters, fantastic interactive listeners. Ollie has thrown this one through, and it's got nothing to do with anything except for being an awesome tune. It's called Super Stripe, and it's specifically from the FM Towns version of Afterburner, which has had more versions than you can shake a stick at. I am telling you, there's so many versions of the Afterburner music, and there's actually, it's on Spotify. Oh no, it's not on Spotify. I found an album of it that literally had something stupid like 300 tracks, and it was the same 5 or 8 tracks repeated depending on different chips and different consoles and things like that. So it's interesting how many different variations Afterburner has had. This is specifically from the FM Towns. Ollie has chosen it out. He also asked me to choose one out, and I'll tell you right now, Ollie, today's playlist was so stuffed I could only just about fit your Afterburner request in. So I will choose from it, but we'll have to get to that next week as well. But I think you guys will be more than satisfied with the slate that we've got set up for you guys tonight. Super Stripe, requested by Ollie. Love this. We'll be right back. ending up with a bit of Duck Hunt there, random abrupt ending. I actually really love that random abrupt Duck Hunt ending so much that I was the one who bloody manufactured it, because it's not actually how it ends. I just loved it ending on that. That's actually the second Famicom medley from the Super Smash Brothers series, in this case used in Super Smash Brothers for Wii U. There are other Famicom medleys, that is, as I say, the second one. I think they pretty much all come together to represent my fourth robot character, and we'll definitely go with robot for this one, because it is Rob from the Super Smash Brothers series, and of course, the actual physical Rob unit, which the character in Smash Brothers is based on, because he's one of, if not the only character, I think, who has never been in a game at all, really, before Smash Brothers, and he was actually just a physical unit. And I know that that physical unit came along with a few games, so actually he may have been a part of them, but I don't know if he was just like some guide rather than a playable character. But it's an interesting one, Rob, because he was this piece of hardware that was really obscure and kind of forgotten about for early Nintendo systems, and then revitalized for Super Smash Brothers Brawl, I think, with this. Yes, Super Smash Brothers Brawl was his first appearance, and he's been around ever since, pretty much. And not everyone likes Rob, not everyone's a big fan of the character. I know he's often come in mid-tier, usually. I mean, tier lists change all the time. Last time I was checked in on Smash Brothers tier lists, he was somewhere in the middle. But I always got on with Rob. I was always able to kick Dale's ass with him, and I was a big fan of that little cutie. And I actually liked the pretty big role that he took in the Subspace Emissary. There was a lot of Rob stuff going on. Jerry's just coming in the chat and said, I don't think he was playable until Smash. No, I don't think he was either, because that was the whole point of this list, is that they were playable robots, androids, and all of that stuff. I think he might have made, he or she indeed, does a robot have a gender? I'm not entirely sure that they do. But yeah, I don't think he actually was playable in those old games that came with the actual Rob system. It's a big blind spot in my knowledge, so I can't tell you. But we all know he's playable in Smash Brothers, and it was a really interesting adaptation to take something that's not a game character, but as I say, actually a bit of hardware. I think that was really fascinating for Nintendo to do with Smash Brothers. And because he's not from a game, he therefore doesn't really have any of his own music, and several little bits kind of represent him throughout the Smash Brothers series. I think whether you're playing against him in a on one of his stages, because even his stages aren't his stages, they're kind of from other games and things like that. It just kind of uses usually stuff from the Nintendo Entertainment System, the NES, the Famicom, which that was a Famicom medley from Smash Brothers 4 Wii U. Actually, not the first Famicom medley, there are a couple. Go and check them out, they're really, really interesting stuff. So that's two down, three to go. Next up, we've got another request that's got absolutely nothing to do with robots or androids. Quite the opposite. We're going into the circle of life, pretty much. Very much living creatures, very much the wild. The circle of life, really. We're going into the Lion King, requested by Jessica quite some time ago, actually, a couple of weeks ago, when she gave me a lot of requests that I'm still slowly working my way through. This is Hakuna Matata, recreated for the SNES, and this is lovely, lovely stuff, Jessica. I've spent a lot of time listening to The Lion King on the Sega Mega Drive, but not much on the Super Nintendo, so here we go. Hakuna Matata, the Super Nintendo version from The Lion King. Thank you. Robo's theme from Chrono Trigger, and I don't think we've played nearly enough Chrono Trigger on this show. And with it being Robo's theme, I think you've got a pretty good idea that it's going to fit in with the robotic theme that we've got on today's show. Is in fact my number three. I'm a big fan of Chrono Trigger, as I think basically anyone who's spent a significant time playing it is. It truly is a magnificent RPG. It's about as good as RPGs can get, really. I remember playing it for the first time on a Super Nintendo emulator when I was about 12 and just being completely blown away. I'd never really played a Super Nintendo level kind of RPG before, and I was only used to, I think Final Fantasy VII really was my first big RPG. And I, for some reason, as a dork kid, I always assumed that like everything before Final Fantasy VII must have been rubbish. And oh, how wrong that turned out to be, because Chrono Trigger is such a wonderful game, and that's just one in, of course, a long history of RPG legacy. What the hell does a 12-year-old know? Thank God I have been able to play the absolute genius that is Chrono Trigger, and actually, having gone back to it today and picked that tune out from it, it's made me want to go back and give it a whole other replay. Want to go back to Chrono Trigger big time, because I don't think I've played that since I was like 15 or something, which is going back 15 years now. That is far too long of a break on Chrono Trigger. I need to go back. Now, I think there's a few versions these days too, isn't there? Because that was actually from the DS version of Chrono Trigger, simply because it appeared to be one of the more popular versions of that track available. There wasn't that much difference. I think it's just the fundamental sounds used. But yeah, it's still essentially got big, Rick Astley, Never Gonna Take You Back vibes, certainly in Robo's theme, which is an interesting reference to draw. So yeah, we've barely talked about the fact that he is my number three in my choice of robots, and that's just because I thought he was extremely excellent when I was playing through Chrono Trigger. I was a really, really big fan of that character, and I think it was around that time that the strange nature of the game's timing and going backwards and forwards in time was really starting to grip into me, and I was like, this is absolutely fascinating stuff. So I hope I'm right that that's number three and that there are two left to go, because my next, I've got some coming up next, and I don't want to get all the orders wrong. But what is next is a red herring. Is something that at first I thought I was going to put into the playlist, absolutely, but I realized that it doesn't really necessarily count. And I've decided to put it in the playlist anyway as a red herring, just to discuss it. Because when I was thinking about AIs and androids and robots to put into the playlist, the first thing that came to my mind as a gigantic Nobuo and Final Fantasy VII fan was wanting to include Kate Sith, who, spoilers if you haven't played Final Fantasy VII, but I assume if you haven't played through the plot at this point, then you don't necessarily care. Spoiler alert, Kate Sith is in fact a mechanical cipher for Reeve, who works for the Shinra company and is actually trying to go against his masters through this animatronic kind of cat riding on the back of a big teddy bear, basically, which makes all the sense in the world. That's exactly why he's one of my favourite characters, despite being not very loved at all by Final Fantasy fans. But the thing is, he's not a robot. He is nothing more than an automaton. He is a mere shell, in my opinion. He's not a robot. I mean, you could argue, you could interpret certain things that he has a certain level of independence from Reeve, but I don't think so. I think Kate Sith is a mere shell for Reeve, because if you start to see it any other way, it can actually start getting a bit messed up. And then it's like, what? So Reeve is some kind of slave trader when it comes to little cats riding teddy bears? Is he just got some kind of factory full of them that he's pumping out? And if they've got independent lives, then that becomes a bit of a moral issue, doesn't it? So no, Kate Sith is in fact an automaton, not a robot, but we'll play a tribute to him anyway by playing his incredible theme, simply because it's one of my favourite pieces of VGM ever, and I can play its bassline. What a big fan of this bassline I am. It must be on one of my old VGM basslines somewhere. That's a playlist on my YouTube. Go check it out if you haven't yet. Kate Sith's theme. Thank you. from an old Mega Drive side-scrolling beat-em-up called Alien Storm. That one is, let me remind myself, We Are Busters. Don't tell Ryder from San Andreas that that's how you feel, because he would not be happy about that. But Busters in this case means an entirely different thing. I believe it basically means saving the planet from aliens, which Ryder from San Andreas might just be happy with, even though he is a turncoat. But let's get characters from San Andreas out of this conversation, because this is number two in my robots rundown. Alien Storm, it's basically your kind of Golden Axe, Streets of Rage kind of game, which is what Shady's been playing on the side for this entire stream. Remember, if you're not watching this on the YouTube version, you can check this out with that stream on the side. It's very, very cool stuff. But on Alien Storm, you are able to play as a robot character called Scooter. And he has a different name on the Master System. What is it? Let me open this up here. Slammer. He's known as Slammer on the Master System, but I know him as Scooter on the Mega Drive version of Alien Storm, which I actually really loved as a kid growing up as an alternative to Golden Axe and Streets of Rage. If I remember rightly, I had it on a cartridge featuring three games, including Alien Storm, Columns, and I think there might have been some other, well, it was definitely a three-way thing, but I cannot remember for the life of me what the third game was. But I'm certain that it was Columns and Alien Storm. And my God, that's enough, to be honest. Both great games, both with great music. It's a really funky one from Alien Storm there. And I would always play as Scooter with, like, he's got like a strange electric whip type thing. And that's the guy I want to be playing as. I always go as the alternate guy if I possibly can, like Shady's gone with the dwarf. It's no fun being the hero. And with the dwarf, he has actually just completed it as I speak. Golden Axe done, that Streets of Rage, and Golden Axe put to bed by ShadyLane this evening. Fantastic stuff. I think we might, because there's still show to go, and I haven't got any pictures prepared or anything, we might try and grab hold of a Bomberman game that he thinks he can have a little run through of as well. So that might pop up in a few minutes' time. Keep your eyes peeled. For now, we'll keep going on the Alien Storm thing, because I loved it so much going back to that. That track was really funky, and it was only like a minute long or something stupid like that, and that's no fun. We want to hear some more of this incredible Alien Storm funk, especially that we're at the prestigious spot of number two in my top robots, androids, or AI characters. Scooter from Alien Storm, a big, big part of my childhood. So to continue on representing him, let's hear Cybernate Q, another great, funky, FM synthesis-packed tune from Alien Storm. We'll be right back. A complete and utter classic from Tallarico, Tommy Tallarico. Let's get that right, Lee. We were so excited to get that out because I'm such a big fan of his incredible Earthworm Jim music. And I think I might be willing to go as far as to say that that's my favourite tune from the first Earthworm Jim game, Submerged. Actually, now we bring it up, another VGM Basslines classic. I remember smashing that out a couple of times on the VGM Basslines streams that I used to do. Absolutely love that tune. It's such a favourite of mine because it's got like three iconic basslines slipped in there, all meshing together, and every single one of them is really, really good. Always happy to hear that. There is no reason for playing that whatsoever except for the fact that I enjoy it. That is literally it. We've got to have a couple of choices on the playlist that are purely for the sake of satisfaction, and that was one of them. We have been attempting to get the Mega Bomberman thing going, so give me a sec here and we might actually be able to get it working if this is a proper ROM. No, it's not. It's another fucking fake file. Apologies for the swear, but we're deep enough in the show now to get away with it. Oh, well. But we'll keep persevering while the next bit of music is on, and I will eventually find a Mega Bomberman ROM. But I think it is still going through the credits, isn't it? And it's currently doing this really funny, like, baseball thing. I've never seen that before. I've never, ever seen that before. That's really, really cool. I don't think it's actually even looping. I think that's new stuff as well. Oh, there they go. They're walking off. So the ending to Golden Axe is almost as long as how long it takes to complete the game itself. And it is really, really badass. I can't believe I've never stuck around to see that whole thing. Must have completed that game many, many times with Shady growing up. So, yeah, we've just been promoting the streams. We've been talking about Earthworm Jim. Want to get Mega Bomberman on in a minute, but that's stuff to do while music is on. But what is the music? What is the music coming up next? We've done 4 out of 5 of my Android robot AI characters, leaving only one, and it's a big one, and it's one that I am amazed that nobody has brought up in any of the chat or anything. It hasn't been mentioned once, unless I've missed something, and that's entirely possible. I don't think it was mentioned once by anybody. And I did have to do some research to confirm that it was actually a robot or an android or an AI character, because I wanted to make sure absolutely for myself. And it is correct. Mega Man. How did nobody mention Mega Man when it comes to top gaming robots, androids and AIs? He was, in fact, created, wasn't he? Isn't it Dr. Light? I don't know all that much about Mega Man. Again, it's one of those blind spots in my knowledge, and it's weird how we're playing a lot of things that are blind spots in my knowledge tonight. Apologies for that. But yeah, Mega Man, wasn't he created by Dr. Light? Either way, he is not actually organic, or at least as far as I know, he's an android or a robot, and you've got to basically say he's got to be the most famous. He's got to be the most well-known, the most iconic. And when it comes to VGM, one of the most satisfactory as well. Oh my god, Mega Man music is great stuff. We heard from it last week. I think it was a request from Lewis, if I'm not wrong, getting Dr. Wily's Castle 1 in. And that was always a complete joy to hear. I love that tune so much. So we have two things racked up from Mega Man right now to hear to represent Mega Man. Both from Mega Man 2. And I'm sorry if that's sacrilege, because there's so much Mega Man that I could draw from for this. But I love the soundtrack to Mega Man 2 so much, and there are so many iconic tunes on there, with Dr. Wily being one of them. That is from Mega Man 2, right? I don't want to eat my words, but I'm almost certain that's from Mega Man 2. And so are these two that we've got coming up next. So it's amazing that all of these fit onto one soundtrack, these classic, classic tunes. And I want it to stay iconic while celebrating the robotic nature of Mega Man. So first up, let's hear Metal Man, and we'll see if Shady and I can get Mega Bomberman going. Right, here we go. Let's just jump straight in. These tunes are so good. We'll be right back. Okay, YouTube crowd, because I'm not going to be able to edit this because of all the streaming, which is absolutely fine by me, because nothing really too bad has happened and the streaming is so cool. Apologies to the YouTube crowd for that little bit at the start of that Mega Man tune where you just heard me go, It was me moving over to mute my microphone and a little bit of breath just popped out there. Apologies for that, fellas. If you're on Audio Boom or Spotify, though, you won't have a clue what I'm talking about because I'll edit that bugger directly out. So Airman there from Mega Man 2, sandwich celebrating Mega Man, is gotta be the number one robotic character, AI, android, whatever you want to call him. It's funny that we've just loaded up Bomberman on the Mega Drive, because I remember looking up to see if Bomberman was a robot, because I thought he might be at first, actually, but it turns out he's not. Literally from Planet Bomber. So they're a species that evolved somehow to regurgitate bombs and have helmets attached to their heads at birth. So not a robot. I did look into Bomberman. And yes, Shady is going to start having a little bit of a play on that soon. He's just taking a little break and we'll get into that. As for the actual music side of this show, there are still a few things to get to. We are kind of trundling our way towards the end of the show. If anything, it's looking like this might be a bit of a shorter show, if anything, because I haven't got certain things knocked up ready to go. But I think Jessica has just mentioned something really good in the chat. Said, Lee, can you play a short bit of Pac-Man? Because it is, of course, Pac-Man's 40th birthday today, right? Unless it was like yesterday and time zones have buggered me up. But it's certainly Pac-Man's 40th celebration going on at the moment. So I think you're right. Maybe when we've got right to the end of this full playlist, and there'll probably be some time left, I might do a little bit of wild card for you. And I'll dig around and I'll try and find some Pac-Man. And that'll eke out a little bit more of Shady playing Bomberman. So I think he's about to get into that in a few minutes. And we right here are going to get into something from Nier Automata. I think that's how you pronounce it again. It could be Nier, but I think it's Nier Automata, a game I've never played, but was brought up again as a great choice to slot into this whole robotic conversation, because a lot of it bases around that. Again, it's not something I know, so I'm going to try not to give too much of a plot summary, because I will definitely make myself look like an idiot. But no, it is almost exclusively based around android and robotic kind of characters. They're a large, large part of the storyline, basically the main part of the storyline. So fantastic choice. And I'm certain it would have ended up in my top five if I'd have actually played it. I need to get out from the rock I've been living under, because this is a particularly gorgeous tune. You know what? Let's just bestow it with the magical label of Pick of the Week right now. I already know it is. This is a really, really beautiful tune called Voice of No Return. And I did actually have a name noted down for who suggested this. It was either Jerry or Lewis or both. I think both of these were in agreement that this is something that should have been on the playlist today. Fantastic choice. Voice of No Return. This is so gorgeous. Meilleur qu'entre un... Serene pocket for you there, and that one was courtesy of Machine Arium, the Glass House with Butterfly really, really gorgeous tune that we have heard remixed into kind of lo-fi hip-hop type stuff in the past. I believe it was Cold Existence was when it was remixed into lo-fi hip-hop kind of stuff. But that is the original composed for Machinarium. Now, we have had a lot of Machinarium on recent shows, so usually I might step back from it. But I know that Ollie is a big, 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 big fan of that game. And I'm really surprised that he didn't mention it when it comes to robots and androids and AI characters. Because, of course, the game is made up of those kinds of characters, of like tin can, tin men, basically, robotic tin men. It's really, really beautiful style. And we have played it many, many times. And I just wanted to revisit it a little bit, just to say mainly to Ollie, hey man, as if you didn't mention this one. Interesting. It's a little bit like Mega Man. And it was cool to see in the chat, you guys were like, yeah, man, as if we didn't mention Mega Man. So yeah, I was glad that I reminded myself that I was in fact an android, because he nearly wasn't even in the list. And then I was like, hang on, he's not actually like a boy in a metal suit, is he? He's actually a robot. And then there we go, number one, straight in. But yeah, that was a choice specifically for my man Ollie and his love for the Machinarium. And I think now we must have played the whole bloody soundtrack on this show, basically. And I think that you'll see exactly why he loves that soundtrack. It's so, so beautiful and dense and incredible sounds, incredible soundscapes for such a beautiful game. You'll never guess what, I was just able to stop Spotify from kicking in on me. I am getting a bit better. I'm definitely improving in some ways. But it seems like my improvements are always at the loss of something else, like the Sound Effects Showdown or the VGM SongFight Battle. Maybe I'll replay the SongFight Battle at the end or something. I'm not too sure. Because I'd really like this to be pulled up to 2 hours. I'd hate for it to sit at an hour 40 or something. That'd really, really wound me up. Because when it comes to planned music, we've got another two tracks, then another two tracks, and then I was going to finish it up. And I'm not sure that's going to take 2 hours. So maybe we'll go a little bit wildcard with the old Pac-Man. And maybe I'll just shove last week's VGM SongFight Battle in there to remind you of the crack before I do actually put the poll up. But before we've got any of that going on, we've still got quite a few tracks to take a look at. And these, or rather this first one that we're about to go into, represents the question that I'm going to pose for next week. Because I really like posing these questions and getting you guys' answers and then being able to put together a top five of my own around it and listen to some of you guys as well. Really, really awesome stuff. And I thought we'd go on a complete contrast to the robotic conversation, to the AI conversation, and we'd look at something very much alive and something very much wild. So to flip it on its head completely, it wouldn't be interesting to then say, what are my top five human characters? That's just boring. And there are so many human characters, it's not even worth attempting to push it down to five. So let's say animals. I want to hear your favourite playable animals. All right, and I'm going to come up with some of mine as well. We've already had a couple in this show that I've thought of, actually. Earthworm Jim. He is, in fact, an animal. He is an earthworm in a suit. Would be a great, great choice. Unfortunately, we've already had him on this week, so I don't think I can have him on again next week. But then again, when talking about playable animals, he might simply have to make his way into my top five. But there are going to be some interesting choices here. I can't wait to see what you guys come out with. For a kind of obvious choice, but maybe not, this is a bit of a flip on its head choice to lead into this question next week. I've chosen something from The Last Guardian, which is a game that I will champion for my entire life. I really, really love that game, and I didn't like how it got just kind of a mixed reception and then forgotten about. Last Guardian meant a lot to me, actually, and got a big emotional reaction out of me. But you don't necessarily play as the animal character within it, Trico, which is a fictional animal. Obviously, these things don't exist in reality, which is a shame because they're bloody awesome and totally loyal if you put the effort in. Last Guardian, of course, centres around your journey as a young lost boy attempting to get his way back home with the help of a rather large beastie by the name of Trico, who, with a little bit of effort, as I say, will help you through your situation and become a really, really loyal friend to you, basically. And as I say, although you don't actually directly play as Trico, interacting with Trico is the game. You couldn't get basically one step further in the game without interacting with him and interpret. I actually think it's a her. I seem to remember reading it's a her at some point, so maybe we'll go with that. But yeah, interpreting Trico's emotions and actually like interacting with it, feeding it, telling it what to do, where to go, who to attack. So Trico is in essence, I would say, a playable character, really, because it's such a big part of the gameplay. But I thought we'd use that to lead into the question, and we'll hear some of your choices next week. I'll start noting them down if there's already some in the chat. We'll see in a second. So, yes, from Last Guardian, we'll hear this amazing tune, which took me right back to my emotional playthroughs, called Victorious. Whoa there, fellas. What an incredible list of answers you guys are throwing at me. Absolutely awesome. And you're also bringing up some interesting philosophical questions, like Spyro the Dragon. Can we include Spyro the Dragon? Because he's only a fictional animal. Are we talking real animals, or are we including fictional animals? That's a brilliant question. And you know what? I am actually not sure. So I've noted down this incredible list of answers for playable animals, and I've got to sift through them through the week. There's still answers coming through that I'll note down during the next bit of music. This one's really fired off. And we'll mull these throughout the week, and I'll maybe come to some decisions as to what exactly counts within this category. But no matter what, I will be coming up with my own top five. There was a slight internet fall there, so hopefully that won't affect things too much. I don't think it matters too much, because I'm not going to be able to edit this YouTube version. So there's going to be little things like mouse clicks, that bit where at the start of the track I went, oh, and all little bits like that are going to be in there. So apologies, YouTube viewers, but you get the extra pizzazz of these streams, which is a lot of fun. I'm loving seeing Shady myself while doing this show play through these games. We've already had Streets of Rage and Golden Axe completely completed. Looks like we'll get a good chunk of Bomberman before getting to the end of this show, which might just make 2.5 hours. Actually, we'll see. But maybe we'll leave Shady finishing up if that's what he wants to do. We'll see. When we run out of music, maybe we'll see if Shady just wants to finish up playing. And maybe we can wildcard until that point. We'll see what happens. We shall see what happens. But we have talked whole heaps of bollocks without saying that that was Marcus's main theme from Detroit Become Human. Of course, we've been talking a lot about the androids, about AI characters, and Detroit Become Human is such an obvious choice and such a big choice and ties in so well to my podcast episode that I decided specifically to not put it in my top five, even though it actually kind of technically is and should be and would be. I decided that, like, we've played so much Detroit Become Human recently, we've celebrated so much Detroit Become Human, that I wanted to give the top five to give some space to some other games. However, I thought it would be a real shame to talk about all of this stuff and not play something from Detroit Become Human. So that is from John Pisano, or is it just Pisano? It might just be John Pisano, and I might have been pronouncing it wrong in my podcast all along. John Pisano's third of the soundtrack, who unfortunately I was unable to interview for the episode, but it's just as good, and I'm certain to be just as insightful as well. Maybe one day we'll be able to catch up with John, and I've always wanted to talk to him about his Marvel Spider-Man soundtrack as well, because some of my favourite VGM is hidden on there. Spidery Melodies by John Pisano. So yeah, Marcus's main theme, more proof of that incredible soundtrack on Detroit Become Human. I think we've essentially ended up the robotic conversation here on the show. I think that's basically it. Three more tracks to go. These two are very, very special. Coming back to an old friend of the show, someone we've played a lot on the show, someone we've interviewed on the show, someone I consider to be a good friend of the sound test, Mike Richmond. I'm looking forward to playing this. There's always a little bit of excitement when we do this. I know Ollie loves Mike Richmond stuff, so we're excited for this. Mike, of course, if you're new to the show and not aware of this name, has worked on all sorts of awesome chiptune in his time. And I hesitate to even use the word chiptune. He composes awesome stuff on all sorts of different chip sounds, Amiga, Commodore 64, ZX Spectrum in this case is where we're going to go. And he's worked for several games in his time, but also he does these really cool streams in which he shows off his process of composing with this stuff. And it's always really, really cool to see. And he's also made his own games. And I believe every now and then you can catch him doing streams of that kind of thing as well, actually constructing the games. I might be a bit out of the loop on that one, but I'm not out of the loop with his musical movements, because this is a theme theme to Vegetables, which we've played before on the show in different versions, but this is the ZX Spectrum version, considering we were talking about the Spectrum a little bit recently. And both of these tunes use AY chip sounds from the ZX Spectrum, which if you are a regular listener, you'll know we were chatting about just a couple of weeks ago. It's where the ZX Spectrum essentially went from being a one channel beeper to, I think it was, three channels of simple waveforms, similar, very, very similar to the Commodore 64, the Spectrum's AY chip. So Mike has been playing with that recently, and this is a new theme he's come up with for his game Vegetables for the ZX Spectrum, and it's different to other themes melodically, so very, very cool. This isn't just different sounds, this is a different theme entirely. And straight after this, we'll hear another ZX Spectrum slice from Mike Richmond. This is lovely, lovely chippy stuff, Vegetables. Oh yeah, I forgot I did that. Shady's giving me a little smirk. I completely forgot I did that, and we can't edit it out because that track was originally going to end the show, and I actually completely added the freeze on the end as an actual part of the track so that it would sound a little bit better than it usually does. I completely forgot that I'd done that, even though it's in capital letters and in brackets next to the title, freeze. God damn it, I should have known that, but at least that's a classic end of the show Tired Lee sound test mistake. Oh well, News Cop getting a little bit antsy. News Cop trying to end the show before it's over, because we've still got one definitive piece, and then we're going to hear something from Pac-Mania to, well, again, using the word commemorate, Pac-Man. for his 40th anniversary. We'll come to that later on, though. That's going to end the show completely. We've got one last request to finish things up, though. Before we get into that, I do want to say quickly that you can look forward to a chat with Mike Richmond next week. We'll be catching up with him, and I'll be talking to him a little bit about AY Sounds and about the Spectrum, because we know from this show that it's a bit of a blind spot for me. So I'm hoping to get a bit of a Spectrum education from Mike Richmond, and just generally catch up on what he's been up to, how he's been, and what kind of projects he might have in the pipeline, as long as he can talk about them, because you never know what kind of projects these guys are working on and whether or not they can talk about them. You know, Fat Bar did the same thing earlier on. They're working on all sorts of things, and you don't want to bugger up an NDA, do you? That's the last thing you want to do. In fact, I will give you a little tease, and I think the way I'll phrase it will mean I can get away with it, is that one of my previous interview guests, and to be fair, that could be any one of like 30 odd people, I've interviewed a lot of people, one of my previous interview guests is currently working on something absolutely incredible, and I only know about it for the purposes of an interview and the purposes of talking about it in advance of its actual release, but it's absolutely incredible stuff, and it's not allowed to be talked about for sure, but I can't wait to talk about that in the VGM world, and there's really, really cool stuff to come from one composer at least, but we know all of these guys are working on awesome stuff all the time. But there's a little tease for you guys. There's certainly another interview to come, probably several months down the line down this point. I don't know how much lockdown might be affecting that particular release date, but yes, very, very ambiguous tease for you guys there. So to end up today's show, we're going to play something that I should have played last week, which was Thor's Choice from the Final Fantasy The Spirits Within soundtrack. The movie Final Fantasy, because we were doing the whole game to movie adaptations last week. We heard one of my choices, I think was it Zeus Cannon from Final Fantasy The Spirits Within, but Thor had made a choice and I didn't see it until it was too late, and I felt really bad about that, so I thought we'd get it on for this show instead. It's called A Child Recalled, and it's by the same composer as last week, Elliot Goldenthal, and it is very, very ethereal stuff, really gorgeous. A Child Recalled, requested by Thor. I don't think we've had a Thor request today, so thank you for this one, Thor, and I'm looking forward to what you throw at me next week. Thank you. a child recalled from Final Fantasy The Spirits Within, the actual film adaptation, which actually isn't adapted from anything at all. It's just a completely original movie created by Square. Were they Square Enix at that point, or were they still Square Soft? I've got no idea. That's going back some time now. But yeah, I assume this will probably go on the Audio Boom version now, because we're at the end of the show now. That was actually going to completely end the show, and we were just going to finish right there. But we've racked up this Pac-Man thing, and I think we will keep it in for the Audio Boom version, because now I'm doing my official goodbye and everything right now. So it's probably best to keep that in, I think. But we're taking a little bit of a risk with this track. We do want to celebrate the Pac-Man 40th anniversary, and I'm very glad that Jessica brought that to my attention. I'd seen it on Twitter, but then completely forgot about it. It is probably something that we should tip our hats toward as gamers. I mean, Pac-Man is a very, very important title and a very, very important character, definitely. But I don't know that much about his music, and we're in a wildcard portion right now, which means it wasn't planned, it wasn't a part of the playlist, so we're taking a risk here. This is just something I've found super quick on Spotify, so I don't, because if I ever download anything off a site, I have to process it to a certain degree, add limiters and such like, which is a bit of a bore. But I'm just going to throw this one on from Spotify, and I've never heard it before, so who knows what this is going to be like. But I'm sure it's going to be fun, because when I put in Pac-Man and Namco to try and make sure that I was getting something official, this is what came up straight away, which suggests that it's somewhat popular. It's called Pac-Man's Park from Pac-Mania. I feel really, really bad that I don't know this offhand, and I bet that I do when it starts. I bet that it's a bit of a classic, or maybe even used in Pac-Man's Smash Brothers appearances, but let's hear it nonetheless, because he certainly deserves to celebrate his 40th anniversary. No news cop at the end here, because he's already jumped in. He's already clocked off. Lazy bastard. So, Pac-Man's Park, Pac-Mania, thank you all so much for listening. It's been another great night. We probably will just end up the stream. We both got a bit tired. Shady doesn't want to complete Bomberman because it is getting late, guys. So, yep, yeah, I'm going to say it for the third or perhaps the fourth time. Pac-Man's Park from Pac-Mania. Thank you again. You guys are the very best.